right. We are early, but we're going to get an early start. How about that? Is that all right?
That's it.
Okay. Well, let's begin with prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for gathering us here again around your word. We pray as we study these basic and foundational doctrines of our faith that you would send your spirit to be our teacher today, that we might be more grounded in our faith in you. Bless this time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we are on the first commandment and the conclusion to the first commandment. You should all have a sheet there, 5 pages. And we are going to go through this mainly as our study today. So here's what we want to accomplish in our lesson this morning. By the power of the Holy Spirit working through God's Word, we will acknowledge the many ways we construct, rely on, and worship false gods, recognize our sin before God and confess Jesus as the Savior, and demonstrate a desire to worship and serve the triune God alone, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's what we hope to accomplish through our lesson today. All right. So, we've got our law gospel focus then on the top of that sheet. And Karen, would you read that for us, please? Just right in front of the top.
Law gospel focus. God commands us to fear, love, and trust Him in all life circumstances. Because of our sinful, self-centered nature, we create our own gods and put our faith in our idols. Yet God in Christ forgives us. By the Spirit's power, God brings us to cling to Christ for every blessing.
Okay, and so that pretty much highlights what our objectives are for today then. It's all about the fear, love, and trust of God above all things. What Luther points out, and if you had a chance to read through what he says on the first commandment in preparation for class today, you'll see that he believes, of course, that everybody has a God. You've got a God, whether it's the true God or some other God that you're following. Even the atheist, Luther would certainly say, has a God. Might be me. Yeah, right. So, but we all have a God, and we'll see how Luther explains that as we go through. So, God is. John, would you read those two short paragraphs there?
Who is God? Who or what is my God? Many people today are asking these questions. Their answers, however, vary as men and women explore different religions, traditions, and forge their own belief, blend of beliefs and practices. In the Catechism, Luther answers on the basis of Holy Scripture the fundamental question, who is my God?
All right. So we see this, you know, in a lot of ways, and we talked about this a little bit in the sermon Wednesday night, in a lot of ways, our society is sort of, it's been described as a post-Christian society. When you've got only 31% of people who are attending church once a month, that's kind of an astounding number. Now, still about 70% of all people consider themselves Christians, but it's only 31% of those that are attending services once a month. And you've got this group of, depending on what survey you look at, it's up to maybe a quarter of people that are now saying that they have no religious affiliation or, you know, nothing like that at all. They're either an atheist or agnostic. And you know the difference between those two, right? Atheist is someone who says there is no God. Agnostic is sort of indifferent to it. Well, there might be. Maybe even there probably is, but I can't know anything about him. So what do I care? That's kind of the idea. Agnostic is more apathetic to the whole conversation, I guess. But for all of that, though, you have a lot of people who are, how would you say, interested in more spiritual things. Not interested in Christianity or the God of the Bible, but they're interested in spirituality. And so you hear a lot of people say, have you heard this phrase? I'm spiritual but not religious. Yeah. That's kind of a thing that goes around now. So the first question then, in what ways is the renewed interest in religion and spirituality a positive factor in today's society? And in what ways is it a negative? How about the positive first? What's maybe a positive of this sort of renewed interest in spirituality and things?
Might convert one or two.
Well, yeah, sure. They might. It might lead them to look in the right place.
Right.
Anything else? What about some of the negatives then? What are maybe some of those negative things?
Lot out there that's not true?
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot out there that's not true.
People rely on themselves.
Yeah, like, you know, it might cause them to just simply rely on themselves, sure. There's a lot, I think, today that sort of masquerades as spirituality that ends up actually being pretty good advice in a lot of ways. You know, if you, are any of you familiar, I've just kind of recently come across, this book. Are any of you familiar with the book, The Secret? No? Okay. This book, it's, well, it's a, yeah, it's, somebody's telling the secret so that it's not a secret anymore. It has to do with this whole idea, basically it's almost the idea that we are our own God, more or less. That our thoughts kind of control what happens to us in life. So we think a certain thing and we send out this vibration into the universe that attracts whatever we're thinking about. So if we're thinking positive thoughts, then we'll attract good things. And if we're thinking negative thoughts, we'll attract bad things. It's that kind of idea. Sort of the danger of something like that is sometimes that does kind of happen, doesn't it? Probably more of a coincidence. And think about it. If you have a more positive attitude about things, what do you think? The things that happen, even if they're bad things, you can put a positive spin on it if you're positive about it. And if you're kind of a negative set person, even the good things that happen, you can find something wrong with that too. So, but the danger of some of these sort of spiritual things is that, you know, humanly speaking, there's certainly truth to it, and you can sometimes see sort of a connection in the things of this world, and so people can easily be led astray by this. You know, there's also that idea, you know, I'm sure you all hear about karma, that gets talked about a lot, you know. You hear people say if something good or bad happens, oh, well, that's karma catching up with me because I did such and such a thing. So those are the kind of things out there. Let's look at the second question then. What evidence of a blended spirituality do we see in American religions today?
What do you mean by blended spirituality?
Well, what I kind of mean is the blending, I guess, of the blending of sort of popular thought in today's world with Christianity, I guess. That kind of idea. Or maybe that's just one example. So you think of Joel Osteen. I'll use him as an example because people know him. Joel Osteen, he preaches this very sort of positive message. And again, he's one of these guys who, if you listen to what he says, yeah, it makes sense for living a happy life and things like that. The only problem is he doesn't touch scripture when he says these things. And he, and if he does touch scripture, it's usually something out of context. And he's so focused on here and now and your happiness here and doesn't seem to have any focus on eternity and things like that at all. So what's kind of the, I don't know, I kind of think, I guess, of that as maybe one of the most dangerous type of things because you can easily get the idea, because it's under the guise of Christianity that that's what Christianity is all about, improving our lives here and now. And it's not really what it is.
Kind of a feel-good
thing.
Yeah,
it really appeals to, and a lot of spirituality today, I think, really appeals to our emotions, right? Our feelings. If it feels good, that's a good thing to do. If it doesn't feel good, you know, then that can't be good. And, you know, we talked about today in the sermon, confessing our sins, that doesn't feel real good, does it? No. And so in sort of this blended spirituality in America, churches that are growing, at least numerically, we might say, what have they done with the confession of sins? Gone. It's not there. Because it doesn't appeal to human emotions and thoughts.
Would praying at every instance by anybody and everybody together, would that fit under here?
Sure. Oh, sure. Yeah. Yeah. The idea of let's all get together and, you know, let's forget what differences in doctrine go between us. Oh, yeah, sure. The ecumenical movement. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that fits, too.
Football players, baseball players.
Well, sure.
All kneel down and pray.
Well, yeah. Well, and you see, I don't know how many of the Twins do this, but you see a guy, I'll demonstrate. You see a guy step into the batter's box. And he steps in.
Yeah.
And crosses. Gets rid of the hit. I mean, just out of habit, you know.
Sure.
You see guys do that. Now you'll be watching Twins games and see how many of the players do this.
And the pitcher will turn his back to the and always hit.
Yeah. Yeah.
He may not cross himself.
Yeah. No, it's not always wrong, of course. I mean, but you know, it's when it becomes sort of that ritual sort of thing. Yeah, I mean, that certainly could be a picture of that, too.
Yep.
All right, third question, then. In what ways do people look at religion as a do-it-yourself project? This sort of touches on some of the things. Kate, did you have some? Oh, no, sorry.
I go to church, therefore God must look at me.
Yeah. Yep.
Works righteous,
yeah. Which, if you noticed in the Catechism, that's really what Luther points out is the worst form of idolatry, is works righteousness. We'll go through that. You know, also in the sense, I think, of it's something that we think we can you know, create and make in our own image. You know, our faith is whatever we want it to be. Not what God says it ought to be in his word, but, you know, whatever feels good, whatever is maybe more convenient to me. That's what religion kind of ends up being all about. So Luther, of course, is addressing these because these things that we face today in our society, these are not new ideas. They're presented differently in our society, but this kind of thing has been happening since the fall into sin. So we're going to read under page 1 then, you'll see no other God. We'll read just a very short statement from the small catechism, both of the first commandments and of the close of the commandments, and then we'll go ahead and read those excerpts that I have there from the large catechism of the first commandment and the close of the commandments. It'll probably be a different translation from what you read, but that's okay. The substance will all be the same. So, on the first commandment then, Heidi, would you read, please?
You shall have no other gods. What does this mean? We should fear, love, and trust in God above all things.
Okay, and Kate, would you read the close then from the small catechism?
What does God say about all these commandments? He says, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. What does this mean? God threatens to punish all who sin against these commandments. Therefore we should fear his wrath and not act contrary to these commandments. But he promises grace and every blessing to all who keep these commandments. Therefore, we should also love and trust in him and gladly do what he commands.
All right. And let's go into those excerpts of the large commandment then, or of the large catechism on the first commandment. Jeanette, would you read those first two paragraphs, please?
You shall have me alone as your God. What is the meaning of this, and how is it to be understood? What does it mean to have a God, or what is God? God means that from which we all expect all good, and in which we all take refuge in all distress. So to have a God is nothing other than trusting and believing him with the heart.
Norman, next paragraph, please.
The confidence and faith of the heart alone make both God and an idol. If your faith and trust is right, then your God is also true. On the other hand, if your trust is false and wrong, then you do not have the true God. For these two belong together, faith and God, Hebrews 11:6. Now I say that whatever you set your heart on and put your trust in is truly your God.
All right, Donna, next paragraph, please.
The purpose of this commandment is to require true faith and a trust of the heart, which settles upon the only true God and clings to him alone. It is like saying, see to it that you let me alone be your God and never seek another. So you can easily understand what and how much this commandment requires. A person's entire heart and all his confidence must be placed in God alone and in no one else.
And then, Jean, if you'd finish that up.
For idolatry happens not merely by erecting an image and worshiping it. Rather, it happens in the heart. For the heart stands gaping at something else. Seeks help and consolation from creatures, saints, or devils. It neither cares for God nor looks to him for anything better than to believe that he is willing to help. The heart does not believe that whatever good it experiences comes from God.
And then, Mary, if you'd read the close, please.
Therefore, let everyone seriously take this passage to heart, lest it be regarded as though a man had spoken it. For you, it is a question of eternal blessing, happiness, and salvation, or of eternal wrath, misery, and woe. What more would you have or desire than God so kindly promising to be yours with every blessing and to protect and help you in all need? But unfortunately, here is the failure. The world believes none of this, nor regards it as God's word.
All right. So anything from there then, or anything that, if you had a chance to read it, anything that kind of strikes you right away as significant in what we've looked at there?
It seemed like everybody has a God, one way or another.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely the point he's making. Even the person who says there is no God still has a God. It's himself, or it's... Luther talks in the Large Catechism a lot about money being a god, of course. Notice he talked about money being a god, whether you have it or not. If you have it, you rely on it. If you don't have it, you're miserable because you don't have it. And so even in that way, it's your god. Anything else kind of strike you right away?
Well, the thing that strikes me, you shall have no other gods. You shall have me as God.
Yeah.
It's the positive part of it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They shall have me.
Yep. And we talked about that on the sermon today of what a wonderful blessing that is, because we have nothing that we can bring, but God helps us anyway because of who he is. Gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. His mercy never ceases. The mercies are new every morning. All of that stuff is true about our God. And so, yeah, that's the positive of what he's saying to us in this first commandment, then, is that, you know, I'm your God, and look at all this you get. Good stuff. So, all right. So let's go into discussing the text then. So question number four then. Describe as completely as possible what God commands by the following words. So fear. What do we think of it with fear? Respect. Yep. Respect. Proper reverence, maybe. Awe toward God. Yep. And what does this kind of lead us to do then? This honor and respect. What should it lead us to do?
Love and trust.
Well, yeah. It does. Cause us to love and trust. I hadn't thought of it that way, but you're exactly right. Cause us to love and trust, yeah. It causes us to take God's word seriously, right? And then it causes us to want to do the things that God wants us to do and to avoid the things that God doesn't want us to do. That's what that fear is all about. We talk about fear a lot in the book of Proverbs. From Proverbs 1, verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. And then we saw, you know, at the end of that section of those first nine chapters in Proverbs, that's repeated again in, I believe it's verse 10 of chapter 9. You know, that's where wisdom is found. It's all found in the fear of the Lord, that reverence, that awe, that respect for the Lord. And then Proverbs 8:13, too, shows part of what the fear of the Lord does. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogance and the evil way and the perverse mouth I hate. So what does the fear of the Lord say? It says that I hate what God hates, which is sin. What about trust? Or love. Love is the next one. I'm sorry. Love. What do we think of with love? Oh, I love you.
No.
Respect. Well, yeah. It's got, you know, a bit of that respect in it. Yep. What does it mean to love God?
I forgot what the Catechism says.
Maybe to put him first?
Yeah, to put him first.
To love him with all your heart, all your mind.
Yeah. Proverbs 3, right? 5 and 6. No, that's trust in the Lord. That's the trust one. But yeah, it applies to love too, certainly. You know, to cling to God above all else. And we were talking about this in a different discussion. You know, love God more than even, even if it causes strife, like in your family, for instance. You know, that kind of thing. Is that the example, Anna?
Put him first in our lives.
Yeah, put him first in our lives. That's what it means to love God. Let's see what else I have written here. Yeah, that pretty much covers it. We could talk about love in Matthew 22, verse 37, 38. Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment." We're going to talk about this a little bit as we go on, but you think this is the first and great commandment. Why? Because all of the commandments, as you pretty clearly see, spill out from, especially if you read the conclusion to the commandments, you'll see how Luther lays that out, that they all really spill out of this very first one.
We should fear no God that we do this or don't do that.
Right. Yeah, that's how they all go, isn't it?
Right.
Yep. All right, what about trust? What does it mean to trust in God?
Depend,
yep.
Lean not on your own understanding.
Yeah, yep. So there's that one. 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him. He will direct your paths. So it's, you know, not leaning on our understanding and, trust him to guide your paths. This is where that word faith comes into play, doesn't it?
In all your ways seems important too. Because even if things seem like they're going bad, trusting in God is the most important thing.
Yeah. Even if things seem like they're going bad, and even and especially if it goes against what the world is telling you you ought to be doing and that kind of thing. Trust the Lord in all your ways anyway. Not most of your ways, but this little category over here, well, I'm going to do what I want here. No, all your ways. We have Psalm 37, 5 and 6 on the screen there too. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. So there are a lot of benefits to trusting in the Lord, not the least of which, of course, is our very salvation. So any other thoughts on those three words then? So question five, then, underline the words in the section of the small and large catechism that point to God's absolute claims on his creatures. If you kind of go back through, I think we've kind of talked about some of these things already. Kate already mentioned all your ways, and you know, the large catechism talks about above all things, right? You'll see that phrase in there. What are some other phrases that sort of talk about this, or maybe talk about some of those words that we looked at in the previous section?
Showing steadfast love for thousands.
Yeah.
I would take, you shall have me alone as your God.
Yeah, alone is a word that I had on there. Right. God alone. Anything else that you see in there? I know, now I'm making you reread the whole thing all over again. Yeah, I know. This is not a good teacher thing to do, is it, Carol?
No.
See? Well, here, I'll give you some of the ones that I had then. I wasn't trained as a teacher, Carol. So I had things like entire heart is on there. True faith, trust of the heart. No one else. You know, phrases like that. Yeah, that's what I had marked. It was kind of those phrases. And others that you could find in there. Yeah, I know.
I told you I wanted to
say hello. Well, maybe I'll have to do that. All right, moving on. Number six, then. What, according to Luther, does it mean to have a God? What does his definition reveal about our human condition?
Bad.
Well, yeah, it's bad. Not good. So what does it mean to have a God, though? What does Luther say about that, or how would you define it?
That's where you turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's real good.
Whatever you need or want. Or
yeah. That's, yeah, it's what you turn to. So, you know, I don't know, think of a problem. Who's got a problem? Anybody?
Yeah.
Okay, very often. So, you know, any problem that you have, it's whoever or whatever you turn to first, that's your God. To have a God is trusting and believing in someone or something with the heart, so to use some of those phrases from before. A God can, of course, be any person or object that has our complete devotion and confidence. The fact that humans set up their own gods reveals one of two things, or two things, probably more. That we are religious beings, first of all, who need a God. And that's why this sort of heightened idea of spiritual things, you know, because we're by nature, and you know, Romans chapter 1 talks about that, right? It talks about this natural knowledge of God that we have, that we look at creation and we see, well, there must be something, you know, maybe you don't think of it as a personal God, but you think of it maybe as a force, or as, you know, like Star Wars, the Force, or something that put everything here. There's something in us, though, that has this sort of spiritual nature to it. And, two, then, that we are fallen human beings. We're separated from God because of unbelief and wrong belief, and we place false gods at the center of our lives, and we all do it. I'm trying to think of... I don't want to get too personal with any of my own problems, but... you think of someone who's sick, maybe, for example. Who do they trust first? The doctor. How many times... For anybody, is it when you face a problem or a decision, is your first inclination to pray?
No. Oh, gosh.
Okay, not that emphatic. No. And do you ever get sort of that thought, and I'm guilty of this too, yes, your pastor's guilty of this too, where you almost get this mindset, well, I've done everything else, so I guess I'll pray.
Yeah.
Why? Why do we do that? Because that's our nature. Because we're sinful human beings, and it's our nature to make, you know, all these other things, my own mind and logic to try to figure and work my way out of the problem. That becomes my God before I say, well, all right, I guess I'll pray about it. That should be the first thing we do. But it's hard to do. So, all right, well, the next question then. List the idols that human beings make in our world today. In what ways do we worship these gods?
Money.
Money, yeah, that's a big one.
Sports figures,
yeah. And the sports themselves. I realized that the Wild game started 10 minutes ago and I'm missing it.
Government, probably.
Government, yeah. That's a good one. Boy, you know, how many political things do you see on Facebook all the time? What do you think those people are trusted in for their happiness? You're a wise man.
Well, they care of us.
That's right.
Yeah. So money, government, sports figure. What else?
What about our family and kids?
Family and kids, yeah.
TV,
movie stars, yeah.
Ourselves to some extent.
Ourselves to a big extent, yeah. Yep. Yeah, some of the things I had here, material possessions, people who have prestige, so those are those sports figures and movie stars. Family is one that Kate mentioned. You know, we worship, well, so here, let's talk about idols then. We can talk about sort of open idolatry in this way. This is usually not what we're talking about, but, you know, Romans 1 describes open idolatry in these couple of verses. Verse 23, and change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. So this is, you know, picture Hinduism, where they actually pray to idols. What they did then in verse 25, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, they worship and serve the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So that's open idolatry. That's the kind of, you know, Hindu worship is probably the example of that. But we looked at all those examples in our Old Testament history of, you know, Baals and Ashtoreth and whatever else. This is the one that gets us more commonly, though. It's the secret idolatry. So Psalm 72, verse 10. Do not trust in oppression, nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. So that's speaking, of course, to money. Jeremiah 17, 5. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. So this has to deal with trusting somebody else, or really self. Matthew 10, 37, he who loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he who loves son and daughter more than me is not worthy of me. So that's family, too. You know, have you ever had or seen a situation where we're afraid maybe to treat family members to... to preach to them the full law that they need to hear, because we don't want to hurt the family relationship. That's putting family and that family relationship above God. That's a pretty common one too.
Especially if you have 7 daughters. It's hard to do.
Present company excellent. In the Large Catechism, then, Luther talks a lot about the fact that we make idols in our own image then. So this is an excerpt from part of paragraph 17, then of the Large Catechism. Everyone has set up his special god, whatever he looks to, for blessings, help, and comfort. And then after this, he goes on to describe various Greek and Roman gods and how those gods kind of fit some of the ideas they had. So ones who, you know, were interested in power, they worshipped, you know, whatever god of whatever power. I don't know. Luther describes it in that paragraph, though. And it really is sort of gods in our own image, then. And so then paragraphs 18 and 19. So even in the mind of the heathen, to have a god means to trust and believe, but their error is this: their trust is false and wrong. For their trust is not placed in the only God, beside whom there is truly no God in heaven or upon earth. Therefore, the heathen really make their self-invented notions and dreams of God an idol. So they make God in their own image then. And we see that in a lot of so-called Christianity, unfortunately, today too. Especially those who would say that, you know, homosexuality isn't sinful anymore because, well, God is love, and God wouldn't want these people who love each other to, you know, not be happy together. That's creating God in your own image. It's an idea of what God is in your mind that does not match with what God reveals about himself in Scripture. All right, then, the next question. So true faith and confidence. All right, okay, that is the right one. True faith and confidence, Luther notes, clings to God alone. Give examples of what it means to cling to God in life. So what do you think? Especially in light maybe of what we've talked about already.
Prayer,
yeah. Yeah, making that the first thing we do. Yeah, that's one I have to remind myself all the time because I forget all the time.
Spending time with God on more than just Sunday?
Yep. Yeah.
Depending upon his judgment that he's doing things right in our life, even though we may not think so.
Right. Yeah, that's a big one. Yeah, because who of us hasn't looked at our lives and said, you know, asked that question, God, what are you doing? So it's, you know, trusting that God has a plan, trusting that God works all things together for the good of those who are the called according to his purpose. What else? Anything else?
Well, let me shape this just a little bit.
Oh, sure. Do that.
Anyway, if and we're on which question?
Number 8.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm starting from scratch here. But anyway, when our reason tells us this is the path we should follow, and yet God's word has a different direction, we should choose God's word, and that can be our guide.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and that's sort of all-encompassing of everything. So, you know, you think again about, like, that family relationship situation where, you know, our mind and reason tells us, well, we want to keep our family close and we want to make sure that family is happy and, you know, don't want to hurt that relationship. But God's word says, you know, if you see this family member in a sin that's leading them to hell even, you need to confront them with it. And if that destroys that family relationship, you know, so be it. you're doing them a lot more harm if you just allow them to feel comfortable in their sin. Because someone who's living in open sin, the last thing they need is comfort. They need to be uncomfortable. So that they turn. That's always the hope. So. All right, number 9, then. In what ways does the first commandment address our inmost thoughts, attitudes, and concerns in life? This is maybe becoming a little repetitious at this point, but
you should turn to God with it.
Yeah.
To the very depths.
Yeah, to the very depths.
Kind of like part of the meaning of the commandment, that will be well with thee and thou mayest live long in the earth.
Yeah.
It follows God's directions and different things in your life. He isn't going to steer us wrong.
Right. So how else does it address it then? And remember that, you know, the commandments, of course, are law. Man, they show us how much we don't do this.
Yeah, and a good dose of gospel someplace too.
So. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Yep. Well, that's why we need that good dose of gospel, because when we look at ourselves, we kind of realize that we're in some trouble. So, and you know, it's often said, and it's true, of course, that when we break any of the other commandments, we always break this one. Every single time we sin, we break this one. And so it's that heavy, heavy dose of law there. Which is why we need Jesus, of course. So number 10 then, tell how the first commandment incorporates all the other commandments. We just kind of talked about this a little bit. But did you have anything to add to that maybe, or? This especially came out in the conclusion to the Ten Commandments, where Luther specifically drew, I think, from the second through the fifth, and he talked about how all of those flow really out of this first one, and then all the other ones too really flow out of this. So you know, if you're truly fearing, loving, and trusting God, and that's why they all start like that in the Small Catechism. Well, it's fear and love, but the trust isn't. You know, they all start, we should fear and love God, because they all connect back to this first one. So if you're truly fearing and loving God, you know, you'll have that proper respect for your parents with the fourth commandment. You won't kill anybody with the fifth one. And remember, of course, the fifth commandment is, you know, it's, you know, hatred is still breaking that one too. You won't hate anybody either when you're properly fearing, loving, and trusting God, as the first commandment says. So every time we break one of those other ones, we're always breaking the first. So that's kind of how they relate. So relate Jesus' life, death, and resurrection for us to the meaning of the close of the commandments then. What I want to point you to here is, let's see. Oh, yeah. What I want to point to here is a couple of the ways in which, because of course, these commandments are all law, so we want to get to the gospel part. And so we want to look at some of the examples of how Jesus kept this in our place. One of these very first ways that we talk about that is in connection with the gospel reading for last Sunday, the temptation of Jesus. So notice how Jesus, weak, you know, he's weak and he comes to be tempted. We'll read through the account again. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry. Now, when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." So you know, the devil first, of course, tempts him where he's going to be weakest after 40 days of fasting. He tempts him with food, and notice the fear, love, and trust of God the Father that he shows there. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. So the devil's using scripture against Jesus here. And Jesus said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. So you've got that Jesus turning the devil's misinterpretation of scripture around, and again, showing that fear, love, and trust in God by pointing back to his word. Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. And, you know, what's the temptation there, of course? Because Jesus knows what he's going to go through, the pain and the suffering that he's going to go through for our sins. And so the temptation here is, hey, look, you don't have to go through all this. You could just demonstrate your power right now. It certainly would have been within Jesus' power to do that. Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. So, you know, notice here, again, what he really would have been doing is relying upon the devil to give him all of the kingdoms of the world, right? If he would have fallen for that temptation, of course he's not going to. He shows that proper trust in the Lord. He does that all, of course, in our place. It's part of his fulfilling all righteousness for us. Another example, Matthew 26, verse 39. He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And notice here again, you know, he knows that this is going to be awful. That he's going to face this physical pain, and he's going to face the much more crushing spiritual pain of becoming the sin of the world. Becoming the very one that God the Father despises in our place. Yet, he bows to the Father's will. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And so, of course, he is living that perfect life again by following the Father's will. And, of course, he's also giving himself to die for our sins. So you've got both the active and passive obedience of Christ there. And then Luke 23:46. And when Jesus cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. And, of course, this shows the trust that the Father has, that the Son has in the Father, even to the end of his life. And so he commits he commits himself into the Father's hands there. Again, part of fulfilling all that righteousness for us. So we don't keep the first commandment. We don't keep it, you know, to say that we don't keep it perfectly is an understatement. We break it all the time and every day. And so that's why Jesus came. He lived that perfect life for us. He always kept the first commandment, credits that righteousness to us, and then he died for all of those sins that we commit. So that's where the gospel, of course, comes in. And those of us now who have faith, of course, will want to, out of love for God, keep this first commandment. We know, of course, that things will go well with us if we do. It's just a whole lot of a better way. So. I think we're going to stop there. You can look through the rest on your own. I realize that I'm probably always going to go long on these. Because I tend to. But this is going to be a real problem because if we don't have Bible class in the summer, then we're going to run out of time before we get to the end of this. So I would encourage you to look through the rest of these on your own and bring any comments you might have on what's left. You can kind of go through the questions and if you want to maybe go through some of the answers there. Spend some time in that personal reflection section too. That's on the bottom there. So for personal reflection, select the chapter from the Gospels and New Testament letters. Read the text carefully for God's law and gospel. On a sheet of paper, write the threats and curses of the law, then write the gospel promise that solves our human need and gives comfort to God's people in Christ. Kind of a neat thing to do to see how our Lord takes care of the problem of our sin. Watch the nightly news or a news magazine program for evidence of false gods and idolatry. Probably won't have to watch very long. Reflect on how the gospel offers forgiveness for human sinfulness and strength to serve God in genuine fear, love, and trust. And then reflect on how God has blessed you through the lives of others who love God and live according to his command. So a couple of things for personal reflection. Unless there are some questions on these questions, we won't go through this in class then. So you can go through this on your own. Do bring questions, but otherwise we will move ahead. And I apologize, I didn't put it on a slide, and I don't have the paragraph numbers, but the second and third commandments, those two, is what we'll take up next time. If I remember to do it, which is always questionable whether that'll happen, I'll send you those paragraph numbers.
Don't worry about not completing it. If the Lord wills, we'll have another year coming.
Well,
you don't want it to, you don't have to complete it in this year.
I suppose that's true. But then you'll all forget it over the summer.
You forgot it for 60 years.
Well, all right, so you're teaching next week then, and all right, well, why don't we close with the blessing? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all.
Amen.